All right, I'm going to be talking about
a guy that I alluded to before.
This is a story of Tom Bradley.
A lovely mayor.
The Bradley Bunch. Tom Bradley, or as I call him, the man who didn't waste any time. Tom Bradley was born December 29th, 1917 in Calvert, Texas to a poor sharecropper family. His grandparents had been slaves. When he was young, the family headed out to Arizona to work on cotton crops. And when Tom was seven, they continued further west to Los Angeles.
Hollywood.
Here, his dad got at work on a railroad where he worked all livelong day. That song's about him. His mom was a maid in LA. Wow, I'm firing off dad jokes. The Bradleys had seven children, and sometime after they moved to Los Angeles, Tom's parents split up. The children stay with their mother.
This is the Bradley Bunch. I think one of them died. Isn't that the story of the Brady Bunch? Like the original husband and wife are dead? Isn't that the implication?
One of them got a divorce and one of them died, I think. I think his wife died and then she got a divorce?
I don't know. We got to listen to the theme song. His wife died. She got a divorce.
No more questions for the rest of the show. Tom attended Lafayette Junior High and then went to the mostly white Polytechnic High School in San Fernando Valley on Roscoe.
Oh my God. Next person also went to that high school.
Oh really? They're probably friends. He also went to college with another black person who was the first of something. I also read that he attended Los Angeles High School, but I don't know if that's true or not. Maybe for like a little bit. Bradley excelled as an athlete and as an academic. He was the first black president of the Poly Boys League and was the first black...
Poly Boys.
And was the first black member of the Ephesians, which was an honor society there. On top of that, he played football. He was a captain of the track team and the anchor of the relay team. He also excelled at the long jump and the quarter mile. In 1937, he attended UCLA, the same school as Marion Matthews, but much later, on an athletic scholarship for track. Bradley became the president of the Negro Club at UCLA as well.
Jackie Robinson was also, he did track. Oh, sorry.
Mother. He was one of 55 black students at UCLA, and he, a classmate of his, Jackie, you won't believe.
Jackie Robinson. Yeah, I know.
I'm well aware.
Keep trying to impress me. That's nice.
He was also the first person to create UCLA. Did you know that? I bet you. Bradley also joined the prestigious black fraternity Kappa Alpha Psi, which was essential in helping him learn how to understand and navigate through the complexities of a predominantly white institution. Mm. Helped him deal with white people, which is hard.
I'm trying right now.
You keep throwing privilege at me, and I don't know what to do. Because I have it too.
Grab life by the privilege. That's what you do.
Grab life by the opportunity. After his junior year, Bradley left UCLA. Did not graduate, but he left in 1940 to join the LAPD.
Why didn't he graduate?
Because he wanted to join the LAPD.
That's weird.
Bradley became a police officer while attending Southwestern University for law at night. There weren't many black officers in LAPD at the time, maybe 100 out of 4,000 officers in Los Angeles. He made about $170 a month, which sucks, but yeah. I don't know what the money was
Step
like.
Stephen Fetcher was making more than that.
He had his name on the side of his car.
The most expensive gas.
My car runs on rhino blood.
Gas that they had to clone dinosaurs and then kill them to make
raptor saliva. $170 a month. I could
clever
see
gas.
God, quit. $170 a month. I could see why cops were crooked. Makes a lot of sense to me.
It does.
Around this time, he marries a woman who owns her own beautician shop, Ethel May Arnold, and begins volunteering for the LA City Council campaign for Edward Roybal, who would become a model for Barack Obama. You might know him, the first black president of the United States. And the man
again,
who,
and there's nothing before Trump for me.
Barack Obama is also the man who failed to save us from Donald Trump.
The man who failed to suspend the laws of the Constitution to not let Donald Trump be president.
A woman in a laundromat told me conspiracy theories, and one of them was that right before he had to leave, he would create a catastrophe, declare martial law, and never leave. And little did we know, two years ago, that was the best scenario. Who would have thought?
Certainly did create a catastrophe.
He forgot the second half of that. I know he went to Palm Springs.
He's sipping on date shakes right now.
Not giving a damn what happens
to
us.
Well, you got a date shake with America right now. We need you back. Take off your sunglasses, take off your Bermuda shorts, let us get a glimpse, and then put on your suit and get back to Washington.
Come take all the guns away! You were supposed to take all the guns away! Back to Edward Roybal, please. Edward Roybal would later be the first Mexican-American to be elected to the U.S. House of Representatives from California in nearly a century. Roybal's strategy came with the support and participation of volunteers and allies across various ethnic backgrounds, volunteers like Tom Bradley, who would use his strategy later in his career, like Barack Obama would. In the 50s, Tom Bradley moved his family. I'm not sure if it was just him and Ethel at the time, or if he had daughters. He had two daughters. I don't know if they went to. They moved into an all-white area at the time, Lamont Park, which is near Crenshaw.
They leave their daughters?
No, what I'm saying is when they moved there, I don't know if they had daughters at the time.
Yeah,
they moved to Lamont Park, which was all-white at the time, and they did this in order to integrate the community, which worked. In 1956, he also passed the California bar exam and graduated from Southwestern University. After 20 years serving LAPD, after being the first black man to reach the rank of lieutenant, which is another first of him, he retired from the LAPD in 1961 with the intention of joining a law firm, which he did. After spending time as part of the Democratic group. In 1962, he ran for city council, and the next year was elected to city council, where he served for 8 years until 1969. That's when he first made a pitch pitch to run for mayor of LA against Mayor Sam Yorty.
Mayor. I like the sound of that. Mayor Goldie Bradley.
He was unsuccessful. Yorty's strategy for this was to paint Bradley as a dangerous radical, which doesn't seem like it would make you lose a mayoral race, but this was 4 years after the Watts riots occurred, so painting a black man as a radical could scare a lot of people in a lot of ways. Sometimes your existence as a person of color is a political or social statement, from what I understand, and Yorty used that, bringing up issues of race and...
Your existence as a political statement.
Because you're a black man who's trying to gain power after the Watts riots, where all this catastrophe...
Everybody got scared.
So, where was I? You interrupted me with your dumb question.
I don't know. You were talking about my eyes.
How do they get so dreamy?
Why are there so many tattoos on them?
On your ID, the color of your eyes is dreamy.
Heaven. Hair color. Heaven.
You already used...
Height. Hubba.
Height. Just right.
Gender. Who cares?
Yordi wanted to paint Bradley as a radical. He kept bringing up issues of race and asserting...
Radical, man.
He kept bringing up issues of race and asserting that Bradley was appealing to the black vote and left-wing militants. On the flip side, some militant black people denounced Bradley as a white man candidate and referred to him as a Uncle Tom. Hurtful on both sides.
We now know there's another name he could call.
don't call me either, please. So Bradley didn't win that election as mayor, and he never tried again.
Oh wait, what's this? 4 years later?
No.
Oh my golly.
Oh no.
He made a second bid and he's coming around the bend. He's catching up and he got elected. 1973.
Bradley! Straight into the city hall.
Not even neck and neck.
Tom Bradley became the first African-American mayor of Los Angeles. He's also the first black mayor of a major American city.
Wow.
I believe Carl Stokes was elected mayor of Cleveland in 1967, but we're bigger than Cleveland.
Yeah, I know Cleveland rocks, but they're not major.
But they're not big, yeah.
They're not radical major tubular.
Many of his backers came from a coalition of West Side liberals, many of whom identified as Jewish, Southside African-Americans, Asian-Americans, Mexican-Americans, labor unions, and downtown business establishments all joined together to vote for Tom Bradley. He accomplished this at a time when the black population of LA was only about 15% overall, which means his appeal was very broad. He was progressive and soft-spoken, and after Yorty, that was a breath of fresh air. By 1973...
Aw, nice. No one's screaming at me.
By 73, the racial paranoia in America was no longer at a fever pitch as riots and a lot of protests were kind of dying down. Yorty's exhausting rhetoric about race didn't work this time, which is how Bradley was able to succeed. Bradley overall had 5 terms as mayor. He was mayor for 20 years from the 70s to the 90s, which was like an area of incredible growth. Yeah. During his second term in 1975, the Bradleys moved from their 6-room Lament Park house to the official house of the mayor of Los Angeles, the Getty House in Hancock Park. The Getty House was donated to the city in 1975, so he was the first mayor to live in the Getty House as the mayor. It's a 6,000 square foot mansion and it's the mayor's official residence. Bradley is remembered very fondly. He was very non-confrontational. He had grand visions of the city and looked over it through the years at its biggest growth, with 70s to the 90s. He was intent on building figurative bridges, not real bridges, although I'm sure he built real bridges, reviving areas such as Watch, which had not recovered from the riots yet. He was lenient on immigration, and for years, waves of Hispanic and Asian immigrants were drawn to the city to have opportunities to build families. He built the downtown skyline.
By hand.
Conceptually.
He's also 4,000 feet tall. Did we not mention that?
Oh, I forgot to mention this about Tom Bradley. He's Paul Bunyan.
I was thinking Daniel Boone again. The mythical giant Daniel Boone.
Certainly not Daniel Boone. If there's a American folk hero, he is not. It is Daniel Boone. He reformed City Hall. He reformed the LAPD. He pumped life back into the financial and business districts. He opened opportunities for high-level jobs and city commissions to women and people of color. He was responsible for enacting environmental reforms for the city, which were crucial for smog pollutions. He set ordinances prohibiting discrimination against the LGBT community during the AIDS scare. All these things as Americans we won't have anymore. During his term, LAX was built. The port of LA became the busiest and biggest in the country, and the subway system was created. He envisioned Los Angeles as a world-class city, which comes into play in 1984 when...
George Orwell
writes a dystopian novel of the same year.
Quick turnaround.
It was January. He was already writing about March. 1984, Los Angeles. He brings the Olympic Games to us for the second time and is incredibly successful. Listen to Grand Olympics.
Yeah.
This is the title of that episode.
Everything. You'll hear it.
Just go through every 2-hour stupid episode.
Just give us money.
With our vague facts.
.com.
He knew that Los Angeles wasn't just a series of suburbs. It was a gateway to the Pacific Rim, which he would call it. And it was a thriving, multicultural, multifunctional city. Mr. Bradley said, Los Angeles is a city of hope and opportunity. I am a living example of that. And he really
city
was.
City of hope. She loves me.
She loves me.
City you of love me.
They love me. Paleta men, you love me.
Bacon-wrapped hot dogs, you are my lover.
His style of mayoring was called low-key, which in comparison to Mayor Yorty, as I said, who was
a big hammer.
Mayor Yorty, who was called flamboyant. They gave Bradley a cell phone for his car, a car phone, if anyone remembers those, and he didn't use it because he saw it as a waste of money. Keep in mind, growing up, the sign of luxury in LA was that you had a car phone and your car had no roof, which together is a bad combination. Everyone insisted that with ponytails was like, that's how you make it in LA. Then you drive through a street that's just only palm trees on a sunny day, and you know you're here. Him and his wife also had permanent seats at Dodger Stadium behind home plate, which is not so humble, but listen, I get it. I want it. I'll do anything for it. Eventually, though, the years of growth would catch up to Bradley. There was almost insurmountable problems built in intrinsically in the city that can't be helped, which a lot of people blame Bradley for. Inviting people to Los Angeles as thriving city resulted in three things. Traffic. Traffic leads to pollution, and we also get overdevelopment. People blame these things on him. These were major issues in his later terms and are problems that remain to this day.
What do you mean? There's no traffic?
I never wait in
pollution?
My life.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong. Overpopulation? There's only two people in this room. What are you talking about? I think you're racist. I think you're a race traitor.
The other day I saw a hillside. There could have been a house there, but it wasn't. We're talking about overdevelopment.
There's grass out front. Someone could be living there.
Oh, it could be a shanty town. In 1989, the newspapers began raising questions about Bradley's personal, financial, and business dealings, which in turn led to the authorities looking into his business. Tom Bradley had been paid as a director or consultant for banks that did business with the city, and as a mayor, you can't have a second job, especially when it has a conflict of interest.
Vernon and Bell.
He also failed to disclose investments and stock dealings that he had been making.
Oh, no.
No criminal charges or any evidence of wrongdoing was found, but his image was wounded by this, and it was his spirit. He paid $20,000 civil penalty for that.
And also his arm.
Also, they wanted a piece of his body, a meaty part.
like the arm.
He had strong arms. Carl Weathers getting his arm chopped off a predator just played in my head, and I got really freaked out by that. By the way, that was the first time in a movie that I saw someone's limb come off as a child. Terrified
me. How's he going to beat Rocky?
How's he going to clap? And then probably the same year I saw Conan the Barbarian and someone gets their head cut off and I thought, well, you can't grow that back. And that was growing up in my house. Anyways.
Well, I guess this is growing up in Greg's house. arms falling.
It's just the sound of arms, swords hitting meat.
Body parts.
Yeah, flailing around. Tom Bradley had to pay a $20,000 civil penalty fee, and he also referred to this as error in judgment by accepting outside employment, but he was really wounded by this and his image was tarnished. Race in these days was also very tense. In 1985, Louis Farrakhan, the minister of the Nation of Islam, gave a very fiery speech, which many refer to as wildly anti-Semitic, and it strained the relations between the black and Jewish communities of Los Angeles.
What?
Farrakhan also said that Bradley bowed to the pressure of the Jewish community and that he also had contempt, quote, both those things are quotes, contempt for the truth and contempt for the black people. Bradley had previously chosen not to comment on Farrakhan before the speech, before he gave a speech, but after Farrakhan's speech, he said that the speech contained a strong undercurrent of anti-Semitism and added, I repudiate racism, hatred, violence, and bigotry by whoever utters it. I make no exception. This includes Minister Farrakhan. This leads to the big race thing. If his greatest accomplishment was bringing the 1984 Olympics to Los Angeles, what tarnished his good name would come after the LA riots of 1992, when the white officers involved in the beating of Rodney King were acquitted. He had prided himself on reforming the LAPD, but clearly he was mistaken in this. The city wanted to get rid of the police chief, Daryl Gates, but he had a virtual lifetime tenure granted by the city charter. It seemed like Bradley, the mayor, was helpless to act. He tried to get Gates himself to step down, but this was blocked by the city council. Their relationship, Gates and Bradley's, was so strained that when the rioting first started, it was revealed that the two men hadn't spoken in a year. The mayor and the chief of police hadn't spoken in a year. There's no communication between the two. The footage of the beating of King and the acquittal kind of broke Bradley. It shattered this hope he had had that a black mayor could end inequality, but it did clearly was not how it happened. At a press conference after the acquittal, he was more blunt than usual.
Blunt talk.
He was more blunt than usual, and he was outraged at the outcome of the trial. He said, today that the jury asked us to accept the senseless and brutal beating of a helpless man. So for 3 days, his progressive utopia burned, basically. He eventually regained his composure when the smoke settled and tried to bring the city down to match his calm demeanor. But many critics said he shared the blame for the riots, which in the end saw more than 50 people dead and the property damage approached like $1 billion. He couldn't prevent the ethnic and racial divide or deal with traffic congestion problem or the threat of real estate overdevelopment. He ran twice for the governor's seat for California. During his first run, he only lost by 1%. If he had won, he would have been the nation's first popularly elected African-American governor, but he didn't win. He ran in a second time, also didn't win, in 82 and 86. In 1993, he decided to not run for a sixth term for mayor of LA. 3 years later, he suffered a stroke.
We wouldn't want to get greedy.
3 years later, he suffered a stroke, which left him partially paralyzed and unable to speak for the rest of his life.
Oh my God.
Tom Bradley passed away in 1998 of a heart attack. Tom Bradley, though, is still remembered as a progressive go-getter and a damn fine mayor.
And the biggest man.
The biggest man this town has ever seen.
You warned me before this that was going to have a sad ending, and I think that tears that people are hearing are testament to that.
I asked a lot of people about Tom Bradley, though, just trying to get, like, I've been trying to find, like, but everyone's like, Tom Bradley was great. He was a great mayor. Mm-hmm. Like, nobody said a bad thing about Tom Bradley.
Except for Farrakhan.
Except for Louis Farrakhan, who I learned to stop calling.
You call him for every episode. What do you know about oranges? Jews.
Okay.
I want to hang up, please.
My mom makes me talk to my... Louis wanted to talk to you. No, Mom, please.
I'm not here.
Greg wants to speak to you. Hold on. Greg. Ah, damn it. The Jews.
He did it again.
He did it again.